You're listening to the audio production of They Were Soldiers. The Sacrifices and Contributions of Our Vietnam Veterans by Joseph L. Galloway and Marvin J. Wolf, published by Thomas Nelson and read by George Kuchs. Foreword and Introduction read by the authors.
Foreword. The Vietnam War came up on my radar in early 1963 through the dispatches of David Halberstam of the New York Times, Neil Sheehan of United Press International, and Malcolm Brown of the Associated Press. Somehow I knew then that this would become an American war and my generation's war, and I had to go there and cover it. At the time, I was covering the State House in Topeka, Kansas for UPI, but began a campaign of begging and pleading to be sent to Asia and to that developing war. Against all odds, I succeeded, and in late 1964, I was transferred to UPI Asia headquarters in Tokyo. In March 1965, the 1st Battalion of U.S. Marines landed in Da Nang in Vietnam, and 3 weeks later I was on a plane bound for Saigon and the war. This would be the first of four tours in Vietnam for me, 1965-66, 1971, 1973, and 1975 for the end. Since then, I've been back to Vietnam 5 times. As a kid, I had read the collected works of World War II correspondent Ernie Pyle and dreamed that someday I might follow in his footsteps and chronicle the lives and deaths of American troops in combat, however lofty an ideal that might be. Now I had arrived and a long, painful journey began. The Marines and I began to learn the hard lessons of both war and Vietnam that spring of 1965. They were fighting Viet Cong guerrillas and finding it hard, hot work in the rice paddies, jungles, and mountains. They pursued a wily, wispy foe on his home turf and seldom caught him. I wore jungle fatigues and little else. The Nikon cameras dangling from my neck and the lack of a rifle over my shoulder distinguished me from the Marines and later Army soldiers. I was 23, only a bit older than the grunts, and I would hook up for a few hours or a few days with a company on patrol. When we came to a halt, the guy next to me would look over and ask who I was. A reporter. You a civilian? Yeah. And you're out here with me? Yes. They must pay you a hell of a lot of money. No, I work for UPI, and they're the cheapest outfit in the world. Then you are crazy, man. The guy next to him would ask who I was. Some crazy reporter, he'd reply. And then all was clear and good. Nobody understands crazy like infantrymen. The learning curve in combat is very steep, and failures are punished with wounds or death. I learned from the officers, sergeants, grunts, and such veteran war correspondents as Dickie Chappelle of National Geographic, Jack Foisey of the Los Angeles Times, Caius Beach of the Chicago Daily News, and others who had also covered World War II and Korea. I also learned by observing, by watching the troops in the field in the crushing heat as they carried packs and weapons and ammo weighing up to 60 or 70 pounds on their backs. I saw men felled by heat stroke in the 118 degrees of the tropics, white foam around their mouths as their bodies convulsed. When a man began to stagger and seemed about to collapse, his buddies would take some of his equipment to ease the burden and keep him up. All the time, they would scan the jungle or the tree line in a never-ending 360-degree sweep like owls. In Vietnam, the enemy was everywhere and nowhere, and nothing could be overlooked or ignored on pain of death and destruction. This was a long time before laptop computers and satellite phones and Wi-Fi connections. Getting your story to the bureau in Saigon and shipping your precious film weren't the easiest chores. I would dictate a story through the military phone system, a shaky, overburdened linkage of old-fashioned switchboards that snaked from north to south and east to west. Each switch had a code name: Tiger Switch, Puma, Lion. All who used that system were ranked by priority, one being the highest, four being the lowest. Civilian reporters were a four at the very bottom and could be disconnected by anyone with a higher priority. That is, until we learned to be Colonel Smith, priority two. But even then, it could take hours to dictate 500 words to the Home Office. For photos, we wrote caption data on the manila envelopes that contained our 35mm film canisters, and then headed to the airbase at Da Nang to find a pigeon, someone traveling to Saigon who would be willing to carry an envelope in exchange for a ride to their hotel or quarters from the UPI messenger who met their flight. The film would be developed, edited, printed, and then taken to Saigon Post and Telegraph for transmission by radio photo machine to UPI in Tokyo, Hong Kong, or Manila for relay to New York and the world. By covering troops in combat, I learned to be a very careful, methodical reporter, double-checking the spelling of a soldier's name and hometown and quoting him honestly. I never knew when my reporting would show up in Vietnam. I could spend an hour or a day or two with an outfit. Then I'd leave to get my story and film out. Because we were a worldwide news agency, the odds were high a hometown newspaper of one or more troops would print my story, and a soldier's mom would cut it out and put it in her next letter to her son. Or it might be printed in Stars and Stripes, the military newspaper that circulated widely in Vietnam. Either way, the troops would read my stories, and chances were good I would hook up with that unit again weeks or months later. You do not make mistakes in stories about men who are armed and dangerous. During my tours in Vietnam, I marched with and befriended young lieutenants, captains, and majors, soldiers I would meet again and again in that war and other wars that followed. In August 1965, I met and marched for a day with a newly promoted major named Norman Schwarzkopf in the Central Highlands out of Duke Coast Special Forces Camp. Norm was an advisor to a battalion of South Vietnamese airborne troops. A quarter century later, in the first Persian Gulf War, he was the commanding general of U.S. Central Command, CENTCOM. He reminded me that my co-author, Lieutenant General Hal Moore, had been his tactical officer when Norm was a West Point cadet. Norm called me to his headquarters in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, 2 weeks before the invasion of Kuwait and Iraq, and pulled the cover off his battle map and briefed me on what he was planning to do. Then he assigned me to, quote, the division which has the most challenging and dangerous mission in my battle plan, and the commander who is most like General Hal Moore, unquote. 10 days before the invasion, I reported to the 24th Infantry Division Mechanized and its commander, Major General Barry McCaffrey. I was given total access to a division preparing for war. In all my dealings with American troops, I was never turned away or turned down. I was generally welcomed as the only civilian those young soldiers and Marines would ever see, sharing their hardships and horrors. I was always willing to lend a hand in combat, to carry water and ammunition or a wounded man. I never presented myself as a neutral observer, aloof from what was happening all around me. These young men America had sent to war, in return, were willing to share what little they had, a drink from their last canteen of water or half a cup of the last coffee. In November 1965, I stumbled into the bloodiest battle of the Vietnam War, where an understrength battalion of the 1st Cavalry Division Air Mobile was surrounded by two regiments of North Vietnamese Army regulars. For 3 days and two nights, it was a bloody struggle to survive against an enemy determined to kill all of us. And on the following day and night, 2 miles away, another battalion was ambushed and slaughtered in the tall elephant grass. These were the battles of Landing Zone X-Ray and Landing Zone Albany. Some 234 Americans were killed and another 250 were badly wounded. More than 2,000 enemy dead lay all around those two small clearings in the jungle forest. Those battles changed my life, changed my heart. I left Iadrang Valley with an abiding love for our soldiers and a lifelong debt owed these young Americans who gave their precious lives so that I might survive to tell their stories to the world. Men died all around me. Others were horribly wounded. Not one of us left that place unchanged from the men who arrived there just days before. I did what I could to help, even unlimbering an M16 and helping to fend off the enemy. For a brief time, I stopped being a reporter and became a soldier. In the process, I found and made the best, most loyal friends of a lifetime and earned the lasting respect and trust of the military family. Joseph L. Galloway, Concord, North Carolina, April 2019.
Introduction. On April 5th, 1962, the morning I thought would be my last day in the Army, I met our company clerk in the unit orderly room at Fort Benning, Georgia. As we shook hands, he said that this was also his last day in Delta Company. His next duty station was Saigon, South Vietnam. Though I was only 20, I had served a year in South Korea and had visited Japan. I had also excelled in high school geography, but I had no idea where South Vietnam was. Before going home, I went to the post library and found Saigon in an atlas. I wondered why we had troops there, even clerks. But then I put it out of my mind. I was headed for civilian life. I had more important things to think about. I wasn't alone in my ignorance and apathy. In the early 1960s, before the low-level insurgency in Vietnam's rural provinces blossomed into an enormous shooting war, in the period where only a few thousand U.S. soldiers were in South Vietnam, few Americans were aware of the fighting there, and few could have found Vietnam on a map. There was plenty to distract us. This was the dawn of the civil rights era, when bold freedom riders, blacks and whites together, rode interstate buses into the deep South in defiance of segregation laws. A time when black students staged sit-ins in segregated lunch counters across the South. A time when black churches were burned and bombed. a time when many African Americans heard Martin Luther King Jr.'s call for nonviolent protest, and others listened to Malcolm X and sought racial justice by any means necessary. The 60s also spawned a sexual revolution. Birth control pills became legal for contraceptive use in 1960. Suddenly, men and women no longer waited for marriage to experiment with sex. Within a few years, millions of mostly young Americans were enjoying sexual freedoms that often shocked and offended their parents. It was
also... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.